Oh, I get it. The air conditioning is working in here. It's actually cold in here. My goodness. It's actually cold. That's what I don't need. I have a cold. Nobody should get within 4 or 5 feet. And is that operating behind me? Oh, you do have the... Oh, great. It is working. That's wonderful. What time is it? Time to start? Yeah, time. Ah. Well, I have this up there because I came down yesterday with the cold that I have. And so I'm a little under the weather. I guess I better leave that there. It might come unplugged. And I thought I would be doing a commentary on this sutra, the famous Samaññaphala Sutta, one of my favorite Pali suttas. But then I realized that I set aside this day in making the curriculum for the course this fall. I set aside this day for a thing about Buddhist science. So that's what I want to talk about starting next week, but I can also start it today, and I can make it bigger so you can see it more easily. I mean, you don't need the ocean wave there. I can make it like that. You really don't need that's what it is, Samannaphala Sutta. And, so I better do a little something about Buddhist science, because some of you might have come thinking I'm going to talk about Buddhist science. And, unfortunately, I will have to be doing this because I do have a cold. I took every kind of thing I can imagine to prevent having to blow my nose, but I will have to blow it. Okay, is it audible? Is everything okay? Is it working, Rebecca? Things are working? Yeah?
Yep.
What? Yes? Okay, good. All right. So, Buddhist science and the force for good. As I told somebody earlier today, I'm being a little naughty in my doing the Buddhist sources of the force for good. Dan Goldman informed me when I came up with the idea of doing it last spring that the force for good was secular. It wasn't about Buddhism, it was about using the Buddhist things in a secular way. Which I think is good, and actually, my idea about Buddhist science is that Buddha himself was being secular in his own time, I think. I consider that he was. So I consider His Holiness the Dalai Lama to be following the footsteps of Buddha himself, Shakyamuni Buddha. Why do I say that Shakyamuni Buddha was secular? People just assume, I think, that, for example, the theory of karma was already existing in Vedic India, where Buddha lived in the 6th, 5th century before the Common Era. They just assumed that wrongly. And they assumed that he wanted to fit into the world religion competition and found a religion. But that was really not the case. He was a prince. He was supposed to be a king. His father went to tremendous lengths to get him to be a king and was really upset when he left home at the age of 29, instead of at the time when he just should have... Well, there are different versions of the story, actually, about the birth of his son. There are two different versions. One of them is very exceptionally cruel to his wife, that she carried the baby for 6 years in her womb. There is a version like that. And I think that's really ridiculous and cruel. And the other one is that she just had given birth to the baby, and it was right after that the Buddha left. Because when the tradition was that when the crown prince gives birth to a son, the father king, in normal times, withdraws from the throne, abdicates, and the son takes over. And so then the father was putting the heat on Buddha once the son was born to assume the throne. And Buddha refused. The only way he could refuse was he refused, saying that, "Well, I would be king, Dad, if as a king I could do something about the problems of my citizens. Because haven't you always taught me that the king should help the, you know, achieve the welfare of his subjects?" And the king said, "Yes, actually, I'm going to put my shoes on because my feet are cold and that's going to make me more sniffly. The air conditioning is just too much. I wonder if we could open the window to get the ordinary temperature. I was just fine a minute ago." And he said, "I would do that, but..." And the dad said, "Well, yes, son, that's what you're supposed to do. You're supposed to defend them against enemies. You work on the education and welfare, this kind of thing." And the Buddha said, "Yes, Dad, but the problems of my subjects are not worrying about enemies as much as they are sickness, old age, even birth, and death. Those are their real problems, and I don't see how I'm going to be able to help them at all by being a king." And the father said, "Well, but you know, kings are not supposed to do that. You leave that to the priests, and the priests leave it to the gods. You know, the priests intercede with the gods, to the gods, you know, for people to take care of those problems. So you just, you know, support the priests, and they'll take care of that kind of thing, and you don't worry about it." And then Buddha said, "Well, if the priests are supposed to take care of dealing with the problems of sickness, old age, and death, they're doing a lousy job. And I think I can do better. And so I'm going to go off and I'm going to seek the meaning of life, the nature of reality, and I'm going to find something, some way to try to help my people, free them from their suffering." So Dad said, "Is that so?" And he then proceeded to lock him up and send in the shrinks, who were in those days the Brahmin priests, you know, who were very learned and wonderful. They knew the Vedas, they performed rituals, they were very wise in ways, and they were the religious people. So I'm saying Buddha rebelled against the religion of his time, is what I'm saying. And he wasn't trying to found a counter-religion. He very carefully, when he set up, once he attained enlightenment, at first he was trying to sort of following what the few Brahmins who sought to realize the nature of reality, not just do rituals, you know, great yogis, and he tried to do that. And he succeeded very well in that, but he found that did not give him the answer, actually. Doing yoga and meditating by itself did not give him the answer. And he was investigating the inner and outer reality instead. And then when he became enlightened, when he discovered the nature of reality, and then he taught and he founded a community. The way he founded the community was, he would meet people, and he would sort of, and when they would be in his field, they would sort of become more self-aware, you could say, "Hey, how are you?" They would become more self-aware, and they would, and he would say to them, "Well, do you want to do what you've been doing, or do you want to know what the nature of reality, do you want to be free of suffering?" sort of thing. He would kind of offer that to them. And then they would say, normally if someone offered you that, you would think, "Well, you can't deliver that, so why should I even think about it?" But apparently Buddha's field was such that they would take it seriously. And then they would say, "Yeah, maybe, sure." And then they would enter his community. He would say, "Ehi bhikkhu, come here mendicant." Meaning, if you have to really give yourself to do this, to follow this path. And then he would teach them. And then mendicant, he didn't say come here monk or come here nun. He said come here mendicant. And mostly to men at first, and later to women for their own community. But with some reluctance he had about that, because he knew that the ordinary society would not welcome the liberation of their female slaves, virtual slaves, to go and seek the nature of reality and drop out of the household and drop out of the childbearing and drop out of the cooking and drop out of all the work that they did. So he was a little reluctant, And also he knew that females were more advanced than males, actually, and didn't need to drop out as much as the males did. And he really knew about that with relation to the males because he had been raised to be a general. He was a West Pointer. He wasn't some liberal arts like sort of woo-woo person at all. He was a military person. So he knew about men, you know, that they're violent, you know, and that therefore they are unrealistic. And they need some special discipline to be able to change themselves. You know, they need a special setting. They need a kind of really rigorous university training. And people say monastic, and it's all right to say that, but it was different than a monastic thing in that they didn't go there to worship God. They went there out of dissatisfaction with God, actually. Like the Dalai Lama is dissatisfied with religions when he does the force for good thing, and he wants to have a secular ethic, and he wants to talk to scientists. He also wants religions not to fight with each other, so that's one of his major things in life. And he is a Buddhist monk, and he accepts that as what people think of as a Buddhist monk. He's thought of as a religious leader, so he accepts that responsibility. But his first thing is promoting human values. Of his three aims in life, his first aim is to promote common human values. As you all know, I'm sure you all know the Dalai Lama. You wouldn't be here. And that means, you know, his religion is kindness, not any particular world religion, you know. And he doesn't, that's why he also makes a big fuss. He doesn't want to convert anybody to Buddhism. He doesn't want anybody who is not a Buddhist to be a Buddhist, because he doesn't want the other people to try to convert the Buddhists or each other and then come into competition for market share and create interreligious violence, which he was talking about and saying that since the 80s, since the 70s, since I first met him, actually, in the 60s. And he was on my case because I was, I won't say anti-Christian, but I was a little anti-religious. And I still am, actually, somewhat. I was once taken to a think tank situation where I was categorized as a religious leader, and I kept complaining. I said, I'm not a religious leader, I'm a professor. Oh no, you're a religious leader because you're a Buddhist, they were telling me. So we got there, and this was a setting where, think tank, where people were talking about how government has broken down, corporations have broken down, institutions have broken down, and then there was a panel of quote-unquote religious leaders. So then different religious leaders gave their talk about what their religion was doing and how great it was. And then I said, I'm sorry to be the naysayer here a little bit, I said, but I told you I wasn't a religious leader when you invited me, but you know, I do know something about Buddhism, but I'm not a leader. And I said, religions have also broken down. There's another bunch of broken down institutions. And why are they broken down? Because they've forgotten that religions are service institutions. They're service industries. They're there to serve people if they can be helped, you know, to have a better life. They're not corporate owner institutions. Their followers are not their, you know, are not their property, you know. They're not their, they don't own their followers, in other words, you know. Like the chief rabbi or the pope or the high top minister or the head of the Archbishop of Canterbury or the mullah this and that or whatever. They don't own their followers. When they think they do, then they are betraying the principles of their founders. I gave a talk like that. I was very much congratulated after the talk by General Petraeus, who happened to be present. Oh, and I wasn't congratulating him necessarily, actually. I was surprised. I'm sorry I keep snuffling, but you just have to bear with it. Okay, so in other words, so the Buddha, therefore the Buddha founded his movement, or his movement naturally evolved. He didn't really found anything. It naturally evolved from the fact that he discovered what was reality. And that is the goal of science, I believe, is to know, distinguish between what's real and what's unreal, and really discover what's real reality, right? Which is why they're very frustrated nowadays. Since 1926, they've been frustrated, because they were very determined for over a century, or more even, that reality was material, and they lost track of matter. The quantum people couldn't find matter, so it dissolved under analysis. And they issued the Copenhagen Declaration, where you can't find the depth of reality, you cannot grasp it with a concept, you can't even see it as an absolute objectivity, because at the micro level, when you analytically have taken things apart and apart and apart and apart, whatever you observe at that level, your act of observation interferes with it, so your mind is part of it, what you're observing. So therefore, there's nothing absolutely objective. So therefore, you can't control reality with a theory. They discovered that. And then I was so pleased a few years ago, not that long ago, I met a man named Henry Stapp, famous quantum physicist, senior, who said after that declaration, even the quantum people split into two groups. And one of the groups, and I never thought of Einstein as a quantum physicist, but you know, he was trying to get involved in quantum. And he said Einstein led the rebellion against the Copenhagen Declaration with his famous statement, God does not play dice, and his idea that he was going to come up with a grand unified theory, and that theory would capture the nature of reality. And many quantum theorists followed that. He gave this, you know, as a quantum physicist, he gave that analysis. And therefore, they got into all these kind of really crazy things like 11 dimensions and string theory and things that I mean, they're beautiful mathematically and they're marvelous. They're like symphonic even. But they are hampered that there are no experiments to confirm or deny them. Therefore, in a way, you find those kind of quantum philosophers shifted on campuses into philosophy departments. We have some at Columbia. Who are actually quantum philosophers. And he said, and Henry said that the actual quantum researchers who came up with things that, you know, quantum computers, you know, quantum this and that, lasers, whatever, tracking black hole experiments, you know, whatever you can call them, all the different things they did, they ignored all those theories. They followed the Copenhagen thing and they said, we're not trying to find the final theory that captures reality. We're working with what happens and empirically. And in doing so, they discovered and they did. That's where the advances in quantum have actually come, according to Henry Stapp, anyway, which I really was so pleased to hear that, because that fit, I believe intuitively that's so, although I can't, you know, I can't prove it as if I'm not a quantum physicist. But in that case, in case Bohr and Heisenberg and those who agreed with him in 1926 in Copenhagen were correct, then that means they verified a prediction, a scientific prediction made by Buddha, known as the theory of selflessness or emptiness. So that's a physical theory, actually. It's a theory that, because Buddha was investigating atoms, and there were physicists in India who had ideas like the Greeks at that time of an indivisible atom as the building block of nature, of material nature, physical nature. They had such an idea. They definitely had an idea of themselves as having sort of moments of consciousness as irreducible cells, as that's me, I'm really here, you know, and I'm something irreducible. And he dissolved not only that internal sense of my point of subjectivity as an irreducible sort of atomic momentic, if you will, entity in time and space, and also atoms are not, there are no indivisible atoms, they dissolve under analysis, and what you find when you seek reality is emptiness, and even the word emptiness is not quite right, because that emptiness is also empty. So, and it's not nothingness. That emptiness being empty, it is the condition that allows things to be relative, fully relative. So it is actually the discovery of relativity. They can go on and on about dependent co-origination, interdependentness and origination, and that pratityasamutpada, but actually the great Buddhist thinker, philosopher, scientist call it relativity. That's what they mean by it, pratityasamutpada. And it's, in one way it's pratityanutpada, the interdependent non-production. you know, because they make a big fuss about actually nothing is produced. If you really look for your own causation, you won't find anything. You'll disappear under analysis. Your sources will disappear under analysis, mental and physical. But that will not destroy you as a relative being. That will liberate you as a relative being to be really responsibly relative. Although there'll be some experience as if you were disappearing in the process of understanding that. And we'll talk more about that later. So therefore, that's why I say Shakyamuni Buddha was being secular in the sense of not following the religious doctrines of his time and not actually propounding himself a religious doctrine about ultimate reality, saying that ultimate, what he found to be ultimate reality in a way can only be addressed by a pure negation. And the word emptiness is a negation. It is not an affirmation. And the word selflessness is a negation. And actually the word freedom is a negation, which could be a synonym of it. Freedom, you know, in America, we think of freedom as like, I don't know, like an empty football field, free, you know, open to be run upon and to fight the other side or something. Or we think of freedom as the aftermath of a battle or something that people in Texas are really into. But actually, we also use the word free, salt-free, sugar-free, trouble-free. We use it as a negation. So free means lack of negation of bondage or binding. Free means. Right? So that in a way, so, and a negation doesn't capture what it negates. If you say there's no elephant in the room here, or, you know, real flesh and blood elephant, there might be an elephant on someone's charm bracelet, but there's no flesh and blood elephant in the room, you never really perceive a non-elephant. You don't capture, the negation of non-elephant doesn't capture anything. It just looks through the room and doesn't find what it was looking for. So it doesn't close around anything, something like that. You could keep on looking for the elephant, endlessly looking for a micro-elephant or something. You know, there's no limb, there's no end to it, in other words. So it is the same as the negation of the Copenhagen Declaration that the deep nature of reality is unsusceptible to expression, unsusceptible to formulation, unsusceptible to theorizing, and captured by conceptualization, which is what it was. And Buddha did actually experimentally, experiential means experimental. So he experimentally verified that in his own experience. In a non-capturing way, he opened his heart and mind and being and time and space and became present in all of time and space, actually, which resulted in an experience of being present in all of time and space, which, if you think about what that means when you say that, you realize that that's kind of paradoxical and impossible. So it's just all you can say is he didn't grasp any particular thing. Right? You can say. Just like, you know, you can talk about eating an apple, but the phrase eating an apple, I'm eating an apple, but what you do when you eat an apple is not expressed by saying I'm eating an apple. That's just one parameter of it, let's say, of what actually happens, right? All kinds of things happen. I have a cold. That doesn't express it. Trust me. So, and then based on that, he decided he would describe the relative, but he, with a caveat, which is just again preceding by 2,500 years, Karl Popper's famous theory of science, that laws of nature, scientific theories are hypotheses awaiting further verification. They are hypotheses that account for experience, experiments, data, in the best possible way, most elegant, most accurate possible way, but awaiting falsification by the continuing accumulation of more experience and more data. So they're not rigid dogmas, they can't be, to be truly scientific. And also, a theory that cannot be experimented, cannot be, you know, tested, is not a useful scientific theory. It's a dogma. the Popper made such a theory. But of course, we take the law of gravity, you know, people in popular sense do take these laws of nature as if they were absolute. And particularly modern science is not just Western, but modern, globally modern science is very hampered by having adopted the dogma of matter and materialism and reductionism about the mind, so that they're operating in a psychotic manner as if they didn't have minds and that they weren't subjectively present, you know, which is crippling to their success, actually, in the long run, although they still have spectacular material effects. Hi. Hello. Are you? Yeah, oh, you're okay. There are some chairs here, but better to stay further away from me because I have a cold. So therefore he made a caveat that all descriptions, although of relative reality, are just that, relative. They're contextual. They're not absolute. So therefore, the theory of karma, which just means causality, causation, is a description of causation at some level that is can be useful, and it accounts for some data that he experimentally encountered by remembering his many previous lives and becoming aware of other people's past evolutionary histories. And so it's a theory of evolution, not a dogmatic one. It could be, it has been found useful by hundreds of millions of people for thousands of years, but it's still not absolute. As the Dalai Lama told Carl Sagan once, who asked him, which we have on video, actually I don't have, but somebody does, on video, they said, Your Holiness, what would be to Carl Sagan, right? What would you do if we set up a foolproof experiment and prove beyond a shadow of a doubt that there was no such thing as reincarnation? Weighty. And His Holiness thinks for a minute and he says, well, I would stop believing in it. He said, I would reject the hypothesis. I would reject that theory, he said. We have to give up our theories if they are, no matter how sacrosanct they may seem, if they contradict evidence and if they are not factual. And Sagan was completely at a loss. He couldn't believe that this famous reincarnate Lama said he would stop believing in incarnation should it be so proved. And while he was reeling from this extraordinary event, the Dalai Lama brightly asks him, now how are we going to go about setting up that experiment? Let's get on it. And he did not have anything to say. So karma, now at the time, the word karma didn't mean simply causality. The word karma meant an act performed in a sacred ritual. Like, you know, you would offer such and such a thing to the god Mitra to see to it that you settled a lawsuit properly, to the god Indra to see that you had victory in battle, to Dyaus, the god of the sky, or Prithvi, the mother earth, who was only one of only two female Vedic gods. You would offer to have, you know, progeny, fertility, you know. And I forget who was the Vedic wealth deity, maybe Agni himself, fire, you know. And so acts that you did toward those gods would then give you a positive effect in your life according to the religion. So that's what karma meant. It was a mystic theory, a religious theory. And Buddha rejected that. He said, it's not the gods. You have fortune or misfortune. You live or die, you win or lose, depending on what you did in previous time. There's a causality, an ethical causality. He made an ethical theory, actually, a biological/ethical theory out of the causality of actions, and not only physical actions, verbal actions and mental actions. And that last was the kicker, because those actions were the most powerful. Because, of course, they motivated good or bad verbal and physical actions. Either greed or generosity, either hatred or love, either insight and wisdom, or delusion and fanaticism and false convictions. Either pride or humility, etc. You can go through all the duplicate good and bad virtues. So he saw, experientially on the surface, just like the quantum people, looking at the probabilities on the surface in a flexible, improvable, perhaps, theory of how people got to be how they got to be. And then, marvelously, human beings got to be human by being ethical in previous lives as lesser animals. They were more, and even as gods, they were more ethical, meaning, because there are some gods who are very self-centered and therefore not ethical. They have great pleasures, but they don't care for their partners in the pleasure. And the human mammal is one who has a natural sense of empathy, although the female does more than the male, which is why he was focused on the males at first, actually. Rather than being a chauvinist himself, he realized the males were in worse trouble and definitely knew that they caused more trouble, which they still do, in fact. I think. Sorry, Paul. If enlightenment is a kind of expanded empathy, such that a person like the Dalai Lama meets someone and sort of feels how they feel, and therefore the way they interact with that person has a good chance of being helpful to that person, or groups of people, because such a being feels how they feel, which is why in Buddhist tradition, to be a spiritual guru, actually, to really be a spiritual teacher, you have to have some degree of clairvoyance. Someone who's not clairvoyant can be an academic type teacher, they can be an informational type teacher, they can be a skill imparting teacher, but they shouldn't try to take on sort of the role of really what is best for someone spiritually. Although, of course, they do so, but they shouldn't, actually, according to the Buddhist tradition, because a true spiritual teacher should really be able to a little bit read the mind of their student to make sure that what they are telling them is helpful to them and not harmful to them. Because Buddha never gave dogmatic teachings in the sense of sort of realistic, intrinsically dogmatic, really dogmatic. In other words, he gave teachings that are really useful, but not dogmatic. And even the theory about ultimate reality, the only dogma maybe is that there's no dogma, let's say, put it that way. Maybe that's a dogma, but that's a good negation. So it's not really, it's a katma, not a dogma. So therefore he was being secular. He secularized the notion that was alive in his society of action being powerful as affecting your destiny. He secularized it and he put the responsibility on the individual that you make your destiny by what you do in interaction with the nature, with other beings, and also in your thought interaction, not just in your physical and verbal one. And this is why there was so much emphasis in Buddhism on becoming self-aware. Because, you could be being nice and then thinking how I wish so-and-so were dead. And that mental killing in the mind is a very bad karma, although you didn't do it, so that's better. But the mind doing it gives you the effect still of separating yourself from that person's life and therefore cutting off your sense of identification with that person and therefore being destructive to yourself and making yourself less of a person, and not to mention that how you will interact with that person, even though you're purportedly doing something positive with them, you really wish they were gone, and so inevitably what you do will be not helpful to them, actually. In fact. So therefore, the force for good of Shakyamuni Buddha was secular in its time. And the karma theory was his proto-Darwinian or pre-Darwinian evolutionary theory, which has all the elements of Darwin that people object to today, the fundamentalists object to today. All those elements about the human interwovenness with other animals, and males' interwovenness with females, and people of different races and nations being interwoven because everybody's been reborn as every other kind of being, actually. So therefore, that erodes that kind of a, even though it's a relativistic theory, it erodes these sort of absolute differences that cause people, put them into these life and death, you know, killing or kill or be killed situations. And also, of course, made them more tending to be more gentle to the animal kingdom because, in fact, the animal kingdom, everyone has been personally an animal. Many, many lifetimes, we all have been. And we've been predators and predated as well. And as predators, we became less predatory and therefore evolved toward being a mammal, and then evolved, which is at least a female mammal has the experience of having their own young inside their body. So their sense of absoluteness, like a reptile, just drops eggs outside. They have eggs only inside, but the actual beings are, they don't have the same sense of connection to like the mammal female. And then the human one in particular is not actually an effective body as a predator, although we reinvented how to be a worse predator, of course. But we don't naturally have a claws and fangs, and you know, we're not that quick on our feet like a cheetah to catch an antelope, you know. So that was the force for good released by Shakyamuni. Then, of course, it became incorporated everywhere here and there as a religion, but since the underlying drive was service of human beings to gain better control of their lives, of their minds, of their speech, of their societies, and to be happier, and to be free from suffering. That's actually what it is, a service which therefore Buddhism was able to get along with Hinduism, with Confucianism, with Taoism, etc. Now and then, when seen as a religion, there was some competition here and there, especially in the courts of kings over the centuries. But basically, it's just like Dalai Lama today wants to have a secular ethic, and he considers secular humanists, materialists even, and he's always was on my case about that, he considers them to be a world religion, a world ideology, if you will, a worldview. And he considers them a billion strong, actually. I don't know who counted that, but he considers what he calls non-believers to be a billion strong. And he kind of upsets sometimes, like Archbishop of this or that, by saying in our interreligious thing, we should have some secular humanists. You know, they should be there because in a way they are a world religion, you know. And he's not favoring, maybe a little bit favors them. Maybe that's one of my debates I have with him. Maybe he over favors the scientists. I don't know. He feels sorry for them. Although once, and only once did he satisfy me in teasing them. I'm not going to tell that story just now, but I might tell it later. Okay. So therefore, I see Buddha as a scientist coming up with, and therefore that makes this era of ours really positive, because we have had the Copenhagen Declaration, and although our scientists are loath to face that fact, their minds have come back into being part of nature automatically by matter disappearing, and they have the theoretical humility by some of their leading physicists to say that we were not going to capture reality in our theories, in our mathematics. And we're not going to be the high priests of a new permanent, you know, religion, you know, which the materialists sort of reductionizing everything and controlling it all, you know. We're not going to do that. Which the British, like someone like Bertrand Russell, you know, Principia Mathematica, he thought he was following on Newton, and he was going to come up with a perfect theoretical notation to fit with the absolute simple elements of reality, material reality, perfectly adapted and fitting to them, so that then finally philosophy / science would have control, theoretical control of the nature of reality. And Wittgenstein sort of did him one better at first and then dumped the whole enterprise. Which I love that, actually. So then now we come to today. So now we come to the sources of the force for good, and we can do so without upsetting Dan Goldman, because actually the sutra that we are going to look at now is a secular document, actually. Although, but maybe by the time it was written as a document, it's no longer secular. I have to acknowledge that. By the time the Sri Lankans wrote it down, about 7-8 centuries after the Buddha taught. And then we think, well, then it couldn't resemble what he actually said in any way. It must have been changed totally over so long. But that's partly because we don't understand the memory, the mnemonic ability of the Indian society civilization in those days. I have a former graduate student of mine, a graduate of mine, PhD graduate of mine, who had trouble getting a job as a Hindu or Buddhist studies or Sanskritist, because there's not many such jobs in academia, in Western academia. So he went back and got another PhD in neuroscience in Italy, and, you know, had a nice diet while he was getting it, and then went and studied Vedic chanters and priests today in India. And they have a brain, their memory area in the brain is like the London taxi driver. It's unique. It has a gigantic storage that accurately stores these Vedic hymns that they recite and chant in the rituals. Thousands of pages of them, amazingly. And although actually the only thing close to it that they have on neuroscientific record are London taxi drivers, the old London taxi drivers. I don't know if the new ones have to pass the test of every little alley and weird thing in London, but the old ones were able to do that. So, okay, so now, the Samana, so therefore, although this was written in the Pali language in Sri Lanka, many, many centuries after the Buddha's time, and the monks had a system, the mendicants had a system in the many, many thousands of Buddhist monasteries all over India and Sri Lanka by that time, where a certain number of monks knew a certain number of these suttas, these teachings verbally given by Buddha, because he didn't write anything down. He made one drawing, but he didn't write anything down once he was enlightened. But they, when they would get old, they would have several disciples who would then, he would transmit the memorization to, who would memorize. And the fact that they kept them very pristinely that way is very, very possible, actually. So, you know, modern scholars like to have this thing of, well, the real Buddha, nobody knows, maybe he never existed. And actually, the Buddhists themselves were asking that question only 300 or 400 years. There's a book called The Questions of King Milinda in English, where the monk Nagasena, the Greco-Bactrian king of a certain principality in Pakistan, who talking to a Buddhist monk in the 3rd century before the Common Era, or 2nd or 3rd century before the Common Era, asked Nagasena, since he never met the Buddha personally, could he allow for the possibility that maybe Buddha never existed? And Nagasena, yeah, that's possible. Maybe it's just a group delusion that I've inherited. But then he had a counter-argument, because the teaching is so amazing, it must have come from a certain source. So the Buddhists were already thinking about maybe there was never such a thing as the Buddha themselves, and rejecting that idea. Because when you read this, you kind of enter Buddha's mind, actually. And that's what we're going to do, okay? Now, Samaññaphala Sutta means, he translated fruits of the homeless life, this particular translator, which is a good, reasonable translation. Sutta could mean, you know, a discourse. In Buddhism, it means a discourse by the Buddha, you know, where it's more or less, although it has some description of how, where it happened, connected it to it, so it's not only his speech, you know, is it about where it happened and who he talked to and so on. But the main point of it is what he said. And pala means fruit or effect, cause and effect. But samana does have a homeless life. A shamana means someone who, a seeker is what it means. The life of a seeker. But in that day in India, the Indian economy and society was so wealthy and so generous that all you had to do was sort of convince people that you were a seeker of truth and you had a lifelong scholarship from the whole society. You didn't have to have a paper. You didn't have to apply. You just stopped working, stopped service in the army. Maybe you had to have permission from your family in some late after a while. And you were supported for lifelong study and meditation by the whole society with an infinite free lunch. Exactly what we don't have in America. There would be a free lunch provided to you by the kings, by the priests. The priests were a little upset about it, but oh yeah. But Buddha was very careful with those mendicants who created this community not to do anything that the priests did, not to do anything religious. In other words, the Buddhist mendicants were prohibited from performing naming ceremonies, marriage ceremonies, divination ceremonies, funerals. They were prohibited from doing any of those things, which was the livelihood of the Brahmins, the priests, which is why Buddha was not crucified, you know, or like strung up or something, because he was leaving them with their livelihood, those priests. Later on, when it became highly established, then Buddhist monks did begin to serve like as priests here and there. But for centuries, they did not. And still, a monk technically is forbidden from doing that. And so when they have their bi-monthly meetings, twice a month meetings, if that's what bi-monthly means, twice a month meetings to cleanse themselves of their infractions, the monks, they, you know, well, I performed a wedding, I'm sorry, you know. I let that couple get into the misery of samsara even deeper by having a marriage relationship. And they apologize to the other monks, and then they're given like so many Hail Marys, you know, so many Om Mani Padme Hums to recite. So now that's what a samana is. So now this sutta is very important one, they consider it, because it's requoted in many other sutras, so it's a good one. Now first, that's what I heard once. It's a mistranslation to, I think, I argue, to say once the Lord. It should say, thus have I heard, or really, thus did I hear once, or at one time, it should say. Why? Evam maya shrutam ekasmin samaye, and the Pali equivalent of that. What that means is, that's the signature of authenticity. Because one of Buddha's cousins, I think, Ananda was his name, became a greatly enlightened arhat, but not during Buddha's lifetime. He so faithfully served the Buddha as his kind of attendant once he became a mendicant that he sort of never had time to really realize the Buddha's teaching. But he was an idiot savant. He had a savant quality. He could remember everything that you said. For 2 hours, he would repeat to you. And he had all of Buddha's statements by heart, supposedly. So when Buddha died, he was the next successor who Buddha designated as the leader of the mendicant community by that time, which was quite large, Mahakasyapa, or Mahakasapa in Pali, kicked Ananda out. And he said, you have to leave the community because you didn't ask Buddha to live forever. One time Buddha said, you know, Buddha can live as long as he likes, and you didn't ask him. So then he died at 80, and we're upset about it. And I don't even want to, I'm almost the same age as Buddha, I don't want to lead this community, so, and you let us down, so you're out. So then Ananda was no longer a mendicant, and he was like, well, bereft, and Buddha had died. So he immediately went into samadhi under a tree somewhere and retained the arhatship. So then naturally they let him back. They were only like putting him out so that he wasn't depending on anybody, and he would have to think it through, you know, and he would have to contemplate it, have to realize. And then he became a great leader of the community, actually, himself. Much longer, because he was younger, much longer than Mahakasapa. He became the second great leader, Ananda. So it should be, thus did I hear at one time. On a certain occasion, period. Meaning, Ananda is the one reciting this. Therefore, the Buddha really did say this. That's what it means. The Westerners translate it like that because they don't believe in the whole thing. They don't think there's any such thing as enlightenment. And they're doing once upon a time. It's a fairy tale for them. So it's very rude, actually. This does have heard. Then once. I even had... Never mind, I won't go into that. Okay. Thus have I heard at one time. Thus did I hear at a certain occasion. And what was the certain occasion? Well, the Lord was staying at Rajagriha, the capital of the Magadha Kingdom. In Jivaka Komarabhacca's mango grove, Jivaka was a famous doctor in Buddha's time. And he, there's a history about the characters in here, which I will tell you. And so he was staying there. In other words, the other thing that the early mendicants didn't have is they didn't have fixed abodes, fixed habitations. But they had different groves they were given. And then when the rains came, they would make little huts for them or some shelters and things. And these gradually became what we might think of as monasteries. But initially, they were so much seekers, and they only ate before noon, so they would not sleep heavily, and they would meditate a lot, and study and think and try to figure out the nature of reality, which is what they were doing. And they were together with a large company of some 1,250 mendicants, it should say. Although we call them monks, you know, but it's different than a religious Christian monk. It's a mendicant, a seeker of reality, a shramana. Shramana also means to wander somewhere, a wandering seeker. And at that time, King Ajatasattu, Vedehiputta of Magadha, as he was the king, having gone up to the roof of his palace, was sitting there surrounded by his ministers on the 15th fast day, at the full moon of the fourth month, called Komudi. I never noticed that. That actually is the day of Buddha's enlightenment, usually. The lunar month, it means. Fourth lunar month. And that is always celebrated as Buddha's birth in the Tibetan tradition, at least, the Mahayana tradition. Birth, enlightenment, and death, parinirvana, a withdrawal from his ordinary body. So it was a very auspicious day. Now, that king, Ajatasattu, was a patricide and a matricide and a regicide. He was an arch criminal. He killed his father and mother, and of course the father was the king, and so he killed his king because he was misled by Buddha's half-brother called Devadatta, who was like the Judas of the Buddha story. A very bad guy. And by this time, this is later in Buddha's life that Ajatasattu is the king again, you know. And later in his life, and so this guy himself tried to kill the Buddha in company as well. He tried to kill the Buddha as well, unleashing a crazed elephant where the Buddha was walking to as a mendicant in his city. And he conspired with Buddha's half-brother to release an elephant to trample him. But when the elephant came up to Buddha, the elephant thought he met his mother or something, and so he just calmed down. Buddha patted him, nice elephant. So they didn't get to kill him, but he tried. So this Ajatasattu was a really ugly customer, in short. And it's a long story about the thing, but he was misled by Buddha's half-brother. Although, just to introduce a different note, that half-brother in the Mahayana is said to have been Buddha's first person in a previous life who taught him the Lotus Sutra. And he's actually a bodhisattva who's being the bad guy in the Buddha story to show the Buddha how he reacts to a super bad guy. That's the Mahayana, and that we'll get to later. But I can't resist putting that in. Anyway, it's the bad guy. So he's thinking, well, what shall we do, delightful friends? And King Ajatasattu, on that fast day, gave vent to this solemn utterance. Delightful friends is this moonlight night. Charming is this moonlight night. Auspicious is this moonlight night. Can we not today visit some ascetic, that's a shramana, he's translating, a seeker it should be, or priest, seeker or priest. You know, Brahman means a priest, you know, like one who does rituals. Seeker is one who meditates and seeks the nature of reality. Some seeker or some mendicant or Brahman to visit whom would bring peace to our heart. Now his heart is not peaceful because he killed his father, mother, and tried to kill the Buddha. But he's forgotten about that, sort of. But he doesn't ask to see Buddha. He just some ascetic or Brahman. By this time, Buddha is very famous, but he doesn't say, let's go see Buddha. Then one minister said to King Ajatasattu, and then I'm going to skip here because I want to get to other parts. So then they list six people that they suggest that he, different ministers suggest that he goes to, six teachers. One of them actually supposedly is Mahavira, founder of Jainism. So he a little bit, in the Pali literature, he has a little bit, has a certain negative, slightly negative role. Anyway, there are six of them, and King Ajatasattu doesn't respond to their suggestions. And we'll find out later why in the sutta. But by not responding, he's not agreeing to follow their suggestion. So he just was silent, means he doesn't want to go there and see that one. Okay? So then finally, at this all this time, Jivaka, that's the doctor, the royal doctor, and a great surgeon actually, supposedly, did brain surgery on some, in some stories, was sitting silently near King Ajatasattu. And the king said to him, "You friend Jivaka, why are you silent?" So then Jivaka answers, "Sire, there is this blessed Lord, Bhagavan," that's one name of Buddha, "the Arhat, the fully enlightened Buddha, staying in my mango grove with a large company of some 1,250 monks. And concerning the blessed Gotama," he refers to Buddha as the Shakyamuni as Gotama, "this is family, that's his clan name, this fair report has been spread about. This Bhagavan," so the Bhagavan means sort of happy, lucky person, you know, Bhagavan means, Bhagavan has a lot of meanings, but it means sort of a share, fortune, and just, I can't resist saying it also happens to mean the vagina as well. So, but Bhagavan is the word they used for God, later Hinduism, and the first use of it that we know of is for Buddha in Buddhism, Bhagavan. So, this blessed Lord, this Bhagavan, is an arhat, a fully enlightened Buddha. Arhat means one who has conquered the enemy of ignorance, so an enlightened person, endowed with wisdom and conduct, wisdom and ethics, better, the welfarer, the happy one, actually. He's not on welfare. He is on welfare, actually, because I told you the whole country gives free lunch to anybody who sincerely is seeking, not to everybody, but just anybody, but to sincerely seeking the nature of reality, you know, a sincere seeker. So he is on welfare anyway, but this sugata doesn't mean welfare, it means sukhamgata, it means one who has gone to bliss. So blissful one is what it means properly. Knower of the worlds, knower of the relative world, that is, incomparable teacher of humans to be tamed, tameable humans. And tame is the word they use for educate, actually. I don't like training all the time. Educator of humans, of educable humans. Teacher of gods and humans, another name. Deva Manushyanam Shasta, the teacher of humans and gods, both. Enlightened and blessed. May your majesty visit the blessed Lord. He may well bring peace to your majesty's heart. And the Jatashatru then works up his courage, because he probably can remember that he tried to kill this particular seeker. But by now, his Buddha has become also very famous and has a large following. So he now agrees. He works up his courage. So he says, "Then, Jivaka, have the riding elephants made ready." He goes on his elephant. "Very good, sire," said Jivaka. And he had 500 she-elephants made ready, and for the king, the royal tusker. Then that's the kind of way they behaved, those Indian kings, supposedly. And so they went, and he brought his 500 wives with him. He really was self-indulgent. And they went there. But now this is very interesting, of course. But when King Ajatasattu came near the mango grove, he felt fear and terror, and the rising of the hairs, you know, on the back of his neck. And the king said to Jivaka, "Friend Jivaka, you're not deceiving me, I hope. You're not tricking me. You're not delivering me up to an enemy. How is it that from this great number of 1,250 mendicants, not a sneeze, a cough, or a shout is to be heard? It's so silent there, you know." But also, unconsciously, he knows he's approaching someone who he tried to kill. And even at an even deeper level, he's entered kind of a closer field of the Buddha. So he's becoming more self-aware, and he's finding deep fear that he carries within him from this really evil thing he did of killing his mother and father, which really stays and haunts somebody, you know, definitely, even though they can live in denial or whatever. And actually, Jivaka did help him in one way. I can say this part of the story, he was going to actually slay the mother with his sword. He was so furious, he had put his father to starve to death in a prison, but the mother visited the father regularly, was allowed visitation, and then used to smear her body with, you know, organic, gluten-free sesame paste and whatever, and he wasn't dying. So then he caught the mother, like, rubbed down with food and honey and stuff. And then he got so angry he was going to kill her physically with a sword. And Jivaka said, no, don't physically do it, that's even worse. At least just enclose her with the father. Because the good doctor couldn't get him to not do it. You know? So now he's feeling terrified, right? Have no fear, Your Majesty, I would not deceive you or trick you or deliver you up to an enemy. Approach, sire, approach. There are the lights burning in the round pavilion where at this point had been built there, which Jivaka, had built for Buddha, which was his teaching place. So King Ajatasattu, having ridden his elephant as far as the ground would permit, alighted and continued on foot to the door of the round pavilion. Then he said, Jivaka, where is the Lord, the Bhagavan? And then Jivaka points out a mendicant sitting there, and that is the Lord, sire, that is the Bhagavan sitting against the middle column. So he apparently was not seated on a higher seat, because he couldn't tell which one it was, just against the middle column with his order of monks in front of him. Then King Ajatasattu went up to the Lord and stood to one side, and standing there to one side, the king observed how the order of monks considered in silence like a clear lake. And he exclaimed, talking to himself, if only Prince Udayabandha, that's his son, were possessed of such calm as this order of monks. Do your thoughts go to the one you love, Your Majesty? Well, then Buddha speaks to him. He should say that. The Buddha then addresses him and says, do your thoughts go to the one you love, Your Majesty? And then, Lord, Prince Udayabada is very dear to me. If only he were possessed of the same calm as this order of monks. No kidding. They should put the Buddha said. I never noticed that. Amazing. A little bit of a, you know, there are always errors and everything. It's unbelievable. So then, the first Buddha spoke to him. And get this, he's killed his own father. So naturally, he's really nervous about his son, subconsciously. But yet he loves him. So Buddha's first thing is to point out to him that you love your son, do you? And he involuntarily says, oh, I wish they were as calm and peaceful as all these mendicants. It's really deep. It's just interpersonal. It's not religion. It's not religion. It's secular. Then King Ajatasattu, having bowed down to the Lord and saluted the order of monks with joined hands, sat down to one and said, Lord, I would ask something if the Lord would deign to answer me. Ask Your Majesty anything you like. And now he asks all these different, you know, professions. And he says, all these people are delighted and pleased with this, you know, the different things they do and the skills they have. You can read yourself all the professions. They themselves, they enjoy here and now the visible fruits of their skills. They themselves are delighted and pleased with this, as are their parents, children, and colleagues and friends. They maintain and support ascetics and priests, like you, thus assuring for themselves a heavenly happy reward tending toward paradise. So he's accepting the social thing, that to support seekers and, of course, priests, that's religious, and seekers are a little different category, but they're kind of making it religious at this point, and they get a good reward for supporting them. Can you, Lord Bhagavan, point to such a reward visible here and now as a fruit of the seeker's life, the Samaññaphala? Now, Buddha, this is why I love this next thing, which I will compress to get through it, to get to the even juicier parts. He then, Buddha, with that, instead of answering right away, he says to him, Your Majesty, do you admit that you have put this question to other seekers and priests, you know, ascetics and Brahmins? And I admit it, Lord, and he says. The Buddha knows that he did. And it's, would your majesty mind saying how they replied, the Buddha asks. I do not mind telling the Lord or one like him or anybody else. He's sort of, anybody asks me that, I'll tell them. Well then, your majesty, tell me. Then he goes through six people, which were the same six people earlier that the minister suggested he go see, and he was silent. Remember, he didn't go. Now it turns out he'd already gone to them on other full moons, asked them the question. And then he remembers, he's not stupid, he remembers what they told him, but he said, but each one of them just told him their theory of life rather than answer his question. So he said, thus, Lord, he ends this first one, but they all end the same way. On being Purana Kasapa, on being asked about the present fruits of the homeless life, explain non-action to me, which is his doctrine, like, you know, wu wei, you know, don't do anything. You know, sort of like Indian form of Taoism, one way of understanding Taoism. Just as if on being asked about a mango, he would describe a breadfruit tree, or on being asked about a breadfruit tree, he would describe a mango. So Purana Kasapa, on being asked about the present fruits of the homeless life, explained non-action to me. And Lord, I thought, how should one like me think despitefully of any ascetic or Brahmin dwelling in my territory? I don't want to be disgusted with him, in other words, because he's a holy person, he's an ascetic. So I neither applauded nor rejected Purana Kasapa's words, but though displeased, not expressing my displeasure, saying nothing, rejecting and scorning speech, I got up and left. Right? So that he repeats this then another five times. And each one gave him a particular theory, and he says, you know, thus he asked about that, but he did it, so I got up and left, you know, and I got up and left, and I got up and left. And he basically, these five, six guys, they have theories of, they're very important all over the literature of the Buddha's biography. And basically, one of them is a fatalist, one of them is an inactivist, one of them what do you call him? He's a starvationist. His group didn't last too long. They didn't eat food. One of them is the Jain, kind of non-violentist and good in some respect, but actually an indeterminist was what they were philosophically. They wouldn't this way or that way or the other way. You can't say anything. And in that sense, they were. He doesn't like them. The king doesn't. So finally, the Buddha says, well, and so, Lord, so he gives us six things that he got up and left, right? And so, Lord, I now ask the Bhagavan, the Blessed Lord, just as there are these various craftsmen, he repeats his original question, and he says, can you, Bhagavan, Lord, point to such a reward visible here and now as a fruit of the homeless life? So now I'm asking you, he says. Oh, I can, Your Majesty. But I will just ask a few questions in return, and you, sire, answer as you see fit. He again keeps dialoguing with the guy, you know, you see. Because why? Because it's like the Dalai Lama. In his presence, in the Buddha's presence, the most important thing is not what's going on in the Buddha, it's what's going on in the king. So he's trying to draw out the king as much as possible so the king can see what's going on in himself. Do you follow? He's not doing it to play tricks with the king. He's really there with the king. But he knows the king will listen best to himself, actually. So he's letting the king come to the understanding. He's leading the king to the understanding. He is truly a great teacher because he's truly empathetic with his student. And this, he knows this student has a deep disturbance in his heart, of course. He knows that, feels that. So I'll keep asking you, he says, this is, what do you think, sire? Suppose there were a man, a slave, a laborer, getting up before you and going to bed after you, willing, doing whatever has to be done, well-mannered, pleasant-spoken, working in your presence. And he might think, it is strange, wonderful, the destiny and fruits of meritorious deeds. This King Ajatasattu Videhi Putta of Magadha is a man, and I too am a man. The king is addicted to and indulges in the fivefold sense pleasures, just like a god, whereas I'm a slave working in his presence. I ought to do something meritorious. Suppose I were to shave off my hair and beard, don yellow robes, actually ochre robes, you know, saffron robes, and go forth, never mind, and go forth from the household life into homelessness, into being a seeker. Suppose I would become a seeker. And before long he does so. And he, having thus gone forth, might dwell restrained in body, speech, and mind, satisfied with a minimum of food and clothing, content in solitude. And then if people were to announce to you, sire, you remember that slave who worked in your presence and who shaved off his hair and beard and went forth into homelessness? He's living restrained in body, speech, and thought in solitude. Would you then say, that man must come back and be a slave and work for me as before? No, indeed, Lord, says the king, for we should pay homage to him. We should rise and invite him and press him to receive from us robes, food, lodging, medicines for sickness and requisites, and make arrangements for his proper protection. What do you think, sire? Is that one fruit of the seeker's life? He nails him. Totally. He says, visible here and now? Certainly, Lord, he has to admit. Then that, sire, is the first such fruit of the homeless life. Isn't that amazing? I think it's totally amazing. That's the Dalai Lama for you when you meet the Dalai Lama. Why do you feel special when you meet him? Because you meet someone who's really there for you, rather than has some agenda for you himself. You see, like it's going to give you a theory, like those other five, six people, they wanted to expound and convert the king to their theory. He's not trying to convert the king to anything. He's wanted letting him see and letting him have an answer to the question. But of course, he's going to go on. He says, but then, so then he presses the game, the king does. He says, but Bhagavan Lord, can you show any other reward visible here and now as a fruit of the homeless life? He tries to still be dissatisfied, so he presses. Oh, I can, sire. But I'll just ask you a few questions in return. And you shall answer, sire, shall answer as you see fit. What do you think? If you had such and such a person, and he thinks, if there were a man, a farmer, a householder in your service, the steward of an estate, he might think it's strange, wonderful destiny and fruits of meritorious deeds. This king Ajatasattu is a man, and I too am a man. This king is addicted to, you know, that same bunch of sentences. They always abbreviate, you know, the steward of an estate. I ought to do something meritorious. Suppose I were to go forth from the homeless life into homelessness, and before he does so, and he having thus gone forth might dwell. Would you then say, if people were to tell you this, you know, there's a guy who used to run your farm, he went and shaved his hair and beard, went and became a mendicant, and now he lives very nice and peaceful. Would you then say that man must come back and be a steward as before? No, indeed, Lord, for we should pay homage to invite him and blah, 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 and feed him and so on. What do you think, sire? Is that one fruit of the homeless life? Visible here and now? Certainly, Lord. Then that, sire, is the second such fruit. Again, the king presses. But, Lord, can you show me another reward visible here and now as a fruit of the homeless life that's more excellent and perfect than these? I can, sire. And now he's kind of got the king connected enough to him and open enough that he now is going to start teaching himself. He says, I can, sire, and please listen. Your Majesty, pray proper attention, and I will speak. Yes, Lord, said King Ajatasattu, and the Bhagavan went on. So fantastic. Your Majesty, it happens that a Tathagata arises in the world. Tathagata, right, you know that, means one who has gone to suchness. So a transcendent one, one who has transcended the ordinary misperceived universe. Doesn't mean he's left the universe, according to Mahayana. According to the Theravada, maybe they think he left town, but not the case. An arhat, a fully enlightened Buddha, and all these are the standard, you know, epithets of the Buddha, endowed with wisdom and ethics, a blissful one, the knower of the world, incomparable teacher of men to be taught, teacher of gods and humans, enlightened and blessed. Gods as well as humans, enlightened and blessed. He having realized that by his own super knowledge, that's a kind of higher knowledge, which is super knowledges are clairvoyance, telepathy, some kind of also almost miraculous powers, knowledge of divine eye and divine ear, ability to hear what people say at a distance and see what they're doing at a distance, five or six of them. Proclaims this world with its gods, devils, and creators, Brahmas, its princes and people, because that's what the people think of Brahma as creator. And they, you know, the Westerners are so ginger about using the word God, they say Deva, but that means God, simply. Mara means the devil, you know. And people, he preaches, you know, but he's not like a Western devil, but he's more like a celestial Cupid kind of devil. He preaches the Dhamma, that's the teaching, which is, he teaches, they shouldn't say preaches, he teaches the Dhamma, the teaching, which is lovely in the beginning, lovely in its middle, lovely in its ending, and in the spirit and in the letter, and displays the fully perfected and purified holy life. This teaching is heard by a householder or householder's son, one reborn in some family or other. Having heard this teaching, he gains faith in the Tathagata, the transcendent one. Having gained this faith, he reflects, this household life is close and dusty. The homeless life is free as air. It is not easy living the household life. I hate my job. I hate my work. And they took my pension, those raider, corporate raiders. Oh, it's terrible. I have to pay too many taxes. To live the fully perfected holy life, purified and polished like a conch shell is better, you know, they should say. Suppose I were to shave off my hair and beard, don yellow robes, and go forth from the household life into homelessness. And after some time, he abandons his property, small or great, leaves his circle of relatives, goes forth a homeless life. And having gone forth, he dwells, and then perfected in morality, sense, towards God, and mindful and aware. And here he doesn't say, would you say this was wrong, because the king has already said several times he wouldn't stop the people doing this. So then he starts to explain, he starts to explain what he had said before about the person. How is he perfected in morality? Well, he abandons the taking of life. He dwells refraining from taking of life, without stick or sword, scrupulous, compassionate, trembling compassionately for the welfare of all beings. Thus he is accomplished in morality. Abandoning the taking of what is not given, and then this is annoying. Basically, he goes through the tenfold acts of positive evolutionary action, secular ethics of the taught by the Buddha. And I think actually, I will, we still have plenty of time. And Sutta 1, verses 1:8 to 27, where he goes on in full. Maybe I'll go back to that. Hold on to your hats. Okay, because this, don't be dizzy, don't try to look at it. Abandoning the taking of life, the ascetic Gotama dwells, refraining from taking of life, without stick or sword, scrupulous, compassionate, trembling for the welfare of all living beings. Thus the worldling would praise the Tathagata, mundane, ordinary, mundane person. Quote, abandoning the taking of what is not given, that's a stealing, right? The ascetic Gotama dwells refraining from taking what is not given, living purely, accepting what is given, awaiting what is given without stealing, abandoning unchastity. Well, in this case, he's a celibate mendicant. And later this is developed into, you know, using harm, you could call it harmful sexuality. It's often translated as adultery, actually, but that's only one harmful thing, where one harms a family, you know, through sexuality. But it can be other kinds, you know, rape, any kind of sexual abuse. Using sexuality abusively is what it is, really. In the case of a celibate monk, of course, it is unchastity. But it doesn't necessarily mean unchastity for, like, a married person and so forth, or for an unmarried person who is doing consensual something. Actually, and it's very well, you know, the Buddhist ethics is very, very, it's a secular ethic. It's very elaborated, and it's basically connected to a biological theory, as I said originally, about karma. Those three, killing, stealing, and using sexuality harmfully, harmful sexuality, are the three negative physical things, physical evolutionary acts that through which a person evolves negatively, or devolves, if you call it, but I don't know what word you use for evolves negatively. But evolves negatively, becoming, in the special sense of the Buddha's secular ethic, where the reason for ethics is to advance to humanity, and then beyond humanity to advance to enlightenment. That's the purpose of ethics. That's the purpose of evolution. There is a goal you can adopt yourself for your own evolution, which is to be perfectly free of suffering, perfectly happy, perfectly unharmful to anybody else, and, you know, blissful. That's the purpose of life, actually. In a long evolutionary sense, that's what all beings are trying to find. In Buddha's secular scientific vision of biology, and those three things are ways of separating yourself from life, because you separate yourself from another life by killing. You separate by killing another being. You separate yourself from another life by taking their property, which diminishes their sense of being. And also, in the time when, as a mammal, who's able to consciously kind of like choose paths of behavior, sexuality is a time when you can kind of melt your boundary of I'm different from you, and you can kind of empathize completely with the beloved in truly loving sexuality, and using that harmfully to just an object, and harming that object through it out of some sense of your separate egotistical pleasure, is like spoiling the most important moment when you could get an evolutionary grasp of non-duality with others, of self and other, if you follow me. So it's equally actually bad. It's like killing and taking what is not given, you know? Harmful sexuality. So these are not said, well, if you do this, Buddha will punish you or send you to hell, or God will punish you. They don't say that. They say that you will evolve negatively. And the opposites are also taught. If you save lives, you save a life and you identify with the other life. So therefore you will expand your sense of life. You will, at least intuitively identifying with the other life, you will feel connected to their life. You give them something and expand their sense of ownership and being, and then you are, in that way you identify with them owning this thing that you gave them. And you use sexuality only beneficially, and then you learn what that means to be more than yourself, to let go of yourself, to give yourself to another being. So it can be a very deep positive evolutionary act, if you follow me. Again, not rewarded by God, not a religious ethics, not rewarded by the Pope, by authority, by Buddha. No, they can reward or punish. But, you know, the action is its own reward or punishment in the sense that it has an evolutionary effect. Do you follow? It's so beautiful. Original secular ethics. Then there's four of speech. Abandoning false speech. The ascetic Gotama dwells refraining from false speech. A truth speaker, one to be relied upon, trustworthy, dependable, not a deceiver of the world. Abandoning malicious speech, he does not repeat there what he has heard to the detriment of these, or repeat here what he has heard there to the detriment of those. Backbiting, you know, in other words, thus he is a reconciler of those at variance and an encourager of those at one, rejoicing in peace, loving it, delighting in it, one who speaks up for peace. So not a backbiter, but a peacemaker. Not a liar, but a truth teller. Abandoning harsh speech, he refrains from it. He speaks whatever is blameless, pleasing to the ear, agreeable, reaching the heart, urbane, pleasing and attractive to the multitude. Like, ideally, he would be a singer, folk singer. He would give his teaching singing. Reach the heart of the, like Bob Dylan or something, reach the heart of the audience. Abandoning idle chatter, that would be the sweetest speech, in other words, would be like musical speech. Abandoning idle chatter, you know, I've had many papers over the years from students comparing these to the Ten Commandments, which then is religious ethics. And some Buddhists will think this is Buddhist ethics, but if they think about it, religious ethics too, but if they think about it, it isn't, because you're not being told that this is what the authority says you have to do and they'll punish you if you don't. So it's religion enforces this, not at all. You're doing it to yourself. You killed somebody, you're going to die by the sword, you know. Live by the sword, you'll die by the sword. They're teaching like that. They're putting the burden on the person, you know, in a science based on the science of their biology and their evolutionary, the fact that they are evolutionary beings in a nexus of relativity. story. Thus the worldling would praise the Gotama. So, well, now he goes into kind of lay ethics in this particular version. And, you know, he goes into what monastic, you know, what seekers do, you know, like ascetics, shamanas, you know. So they don't eat at night, they don't go to shows, they don't dress up and put on makeup, they don't use high beds, they don't touch money, they don't accept raw grain, they don't accept gifts of women and young girls, male or female slaves, sheep and goats, cocks and pigs, elephants, cattle, horses and mares, fields and plots like property, which this was that ancient society. He's not saying there's anything good about it, just saying they would not do that. He refrains from running errands, from buying and selling, from cheating with false weights and measures, from bribery and corruption, deception and sincerity, wounding, killing, imprisoning, highway robbery, and taking food by force. That's the world and praise the Tathagata. So those are more social things. And, you know, this actually shows bad things that some of the fake seekers do. You know, they use their sort of holiness to grab stuff. He tells the king. This is all repeated in the later sutra that we're reading. And he's not doing the mental ones, I think, then he says, you know, whereas some ascetics and Brahmins, you know, that is, seekers and priests, remain addicted to disputations such as, you don't understand this doctrine and discipline, I do. How could you understand this doctrine and discipline? Your way is all wrong, mine is right. I'm consistent, you aren't. You said last what you have said first, first what you have last. In other words, they don't try to dominate people with speech. Buddhists don't. And they don't run errands. He's elaborating what all those things are. He's challenging, actually, the bad ethics of religious ascetics, you know, holy people. Bad behavior of holy men. And I just was wanting to see if he had the mental ethic, because the mental ethic, so now he goes into, in a way he does, because the three negative mental ones in the tenfold path of liberal action are greed, greedy mind, malicious mind, and deluded mind. And then he goes into, of course, a long thing about wrong worldviews or deluded worldviews of different kinds. Amazing long thing about that. So, okay, back to our sutra. Now, back to our sutra. Oh, yeah. Okay. No, that's where his king is doing this. He got the king, and then he goes, perfected immorality, abandoning it. So then this is, you know, verses 1.8 to 2.7, you see. They did this in this publication, which annoys me. I don't want them to print the whole thing. But they're saving paper. They're saving paper. Because students who read it, they're not going to go back often and read it. So, then sire, that monk who has perfected immorality, that mendicant sees no danger from any side owing to his being restrained by morality. Just as a duly anointed kshatriya king, you know, kshatriya king, you know, warrior king, having conquered his enemies, by that very fact sees no danger from any side, so the mendicant, on account of his morality, sees no danger anywhere. He experiences in himself the blameless bliss that comes from maintaining this noble, you shouldn't say arin, this noble morality. In this way, sire, he's perfected in morality. And then he goes on a long thing about the discipline of the mendicant to guard the sense doors, which I think I will skip. But we can skip that. But you know, this is part of the discipline of the mendicant. Like, you don't just look around, you don't listen, you don't keep the radio on all day or the TV on. You know, you choose what you're going to see and hear so that you don't impress your mind with things to keep your calm. You know, the secret doesn't do like that. Now he comes to mindfulness. And how, sire, is a monk accomplished in mindfulness and clear awareness? Here a monk acts with clear awareness in going forth and back. So this is the seventh branch of the noble path, mindfulness and clear awareness. And really great. Here a monk acts in going forth and back, in looking ahead or behind him, in bending and stretching, in wearing his outer and inner robe and carrying his bowl, in eating, drinking, chewing and swallowing, evacuating and urinating, in walking, standing, sitting, lying down, in waking and speaking, and in keeping silent, he acts with clear awareness. In this way, a mendicant is accomplished in mindfulness and clear awareness. And how is a mendicant contented? Here a mendicant is satisfied with a robe to protect his body, with alms to satisfy his stomach, and having accepted sufficient, he goes on his way, just as a bird with wings flies hither and thither, burdened by nothing but its wings, and so he is satisfied. In this way, sire, a monk is contented. Then he, equipped with this noble morality, he shouldn't really translate Arya like that. The word Arya was originally, in the Vedic period, a racist term. It referred to the Central Asian, at that time, whiteys who came in chariots and crushed an urban civilization in the Indus Valley in India, a huge one, bigger than Egypt, 35 times bigger than Egypt, and slowly crushed, not all in one battle, but slowly crushed city by city, and then became the masters of the remnants of those people. Many of them fled to the south, or what are called the Dravidian people today, I believe. And most theories agree with that. And although it's not well known, because the original Harappan one is not well archaeologized. And then by Buddha's time, though, it had become a class term, caste term of the three higher castes, and not the majority of workers population called Shudras. And then Buddha made a new meaning of it, Aryan, where noble, he meant noble, but he redefined noble. And he redefined noble as a person who has achieved a degree of altruism, by having had a certain degree of realization of the lack of a fixated self, not the full blast one, but a few hinted experiences of it. Like what they call beautifully in Zen, had the experience of his face falling off. Zen is really cool. Persona, in Latin means a mask. So, one sense of I'm me, then it has a sense of your face. So there's a degree where you feel that, and automatically, to whatever degree one feels, one has a kind of slippage of the sense of I'm just absolutely me in here inside my skin. To whatever degree one has, there's some slippage of that, not the full blast oneness experience, but some degree of it. Then one becomes noble in the sense of aware of the existence of the other as equal to oneself, therefore having a kind of noblesse oblige. And he redefined it like that. So he shouldn't intrude this word which Hitler heard from some idiot and went on about Aryans, So the translator is stupid to do that. I'm sorry. I apologize. He's a nice Mr. Walsh, nice man, if he's still alive. But that was not good. It's bad. It's rude. It's not correct. Noble morality is good. Because these guys are noble. Some of them are untouchables, actually. Some of them are released slaves that joined his thing. And then later, some of them are women. And they are noble because of their empathy, and they're identifying with others, and therefore being altruistic with them, to at least some degree. That's what noble means to Buddha. He explains that in other places. Anyway, so he has the noble morality, noble restraint of the senses, and noble contentment. Finds a solitary lodging at the root of a forest tree, or in a mountain cave or gorge, a charnel ground, a jungle thicket, or in the open air on a heap of straw. Then, having eaten after his return from the alms round, he sits down cross-legged, holding his body erect, and concentrates on keeping mindfulness established before him. Abandoning worldly desires, he dwells with the mind freed from worldly desires, and his mind is purified of them. Abandoning ill will and hatred, and by compassionate love for the welfare of all living beings, his mind is purified of ill will and hatred. Abandoning sloth and torpor, perceiving light, mindful, and clearly aware, his mind is purified of sloth and torpor. Abandoning, this I do like, worry and flurry, harubaro they say in Tibetan, and with an inwardly calmed mind, his mind is purified of worry and flurry, abandoning paralyzing doubt, because he actually wants a certain type of critical doubt, but abandoning paralyzing doubt, he dwells with doubt left behind, without uncertainty as to what things are wholesome, and his mind is purified of doubt. Just as a man who had taken a loan, and he has all just as a man, different ways. It's very lovely he goes through all these things. You know, he has like five or six just as a man's of wonderful things. So he's showing by using these things about this man like this, and a man was formerly a slave, now I'm not a slave. Man was finally, we got to, got through the desert, and he got bound in prison and got to be freed, and suffering terribly sick and got to be well, and taken a loan and got to be able to pay it back. He's very happy, in other words. And so just as long, sire, as a mendicant does not perceive the disappearance of the five hindrances in himself, he feels as if in debt, in sickness, in bonds, in slavery, on a desert journey. But when he perceives the disappearance of these five hindrances in himself, it is as if obstacles, nowadays we translate that usually, it is as if he were freed from debt, but hindrance is good actually, from sickness, from bonds, from slavery, from the perils of the desert. And this is quite beautiful, and I think I might stop here. Now, and when he knows that these five hindrances have left him, gladness arises in him. From gladness come, now this is what we're talking about. See, gladness, he doesn't say gladness comes from because he meditated for 3 hours or because he did this and that. He says those hindrances are gone from his mind. So therefore, this wells up from the reality of his own being. So gladness arises in him. From gladness comes delight. From the delight in his mind, his body is tranquilized. His body feels peaceful, tranquilized. With a tranquil body, with a peaceful body, he feels joy. And with joy, his mind is more concentrated. Being thus detached from sense desires, detached from unwholesome states, he enters and remains in the first contemplative space or realm, which is with, he's still thinking there and still pondering, born of detachment and filled with delight and joy. And with this delight and joy, born of detachment, he so suffuses, drenches, fills, and irradiates his body that there is no spot in his entire body that is untouched by this delight and joy born of detachment. So, you know, since he's bringing the king with him, having gotten the king by letting the king talk at first and letting the king see a social benefit and therefore realize that he's sort of onto something here, by this description, he, like a skilled artist, he is creating this state, a hint of this state in the mind of the king. And this is to the king such a huge relief, who has this deep anxiety in his heart because of his murders, patricide and matricide, killing the mother. It's like unbelievable. You know, this, and it's well translated, like suffuses, drenches, fills like fluid, you know, fills and irradiates. It's like it's the flow, you know, of this natural gladness that arises from a mind that is undisturbed and not freaked out and not engaged in seeking this or feeling angry about that or whatever, you know. It's not just sitting there watching these things. That was the beginning. But now, by having edited the thoughts, having corrected them, having seen through, then he's seen the non-necessity, critically evaluated negative thought states and removed them, you know, dissociated from them, then the natural joy of life is able to come up out of his being, the natural joy of life that the Buddha proclaimed with the Four Noble Truths. Because nirvana is the natural nature of reality. That's what the Buddha's taught. This Theravada, even though they consider themselves like dualistic Buddhists, and they think that's what Buddha taught, some special dualistic thing, and then later somebody added some crazy thing because they wanted to be popular with the Hindus. And that's what modern scholars also think about Mahayana, but totally wrong. The Four Noble Truths, the very first teaching, is the Buddha's announcement that life is bliss. That's the real nature of life. They misperceive life as suffering, thinking you're it and the universe is different from you and you have to struggle against it and you're going to lose. That's suffering, but that's not reality. And reality also is that is not that you don't exist and it doesn't exist. Reality is that you are a part of a relativity that is blissful, naturally, when not interfered with by stupidity and ignorance. And he goes into this kneading and drenching and this flow thing. I will go a little further with it. Just as a skilled bath man or his assistant, here you appear. Now that king must have a hell of a spa in his palace and massages and all kinds of waiters and skilled masseurs and things, right? Kneading the soap powder, which he has sprinkled with water, forms from it in a metal dish a soft lump, so that the ball of soap powder becomes one oleaginous mass, bound with oil so that nothing escapes. So this mendicant suffuses, drenches, fills, and irradiates his body so that no spot remains untouched. A really sensual thing. He takes the king back through his own massage parlor. This, sire, is a fruit of the homeless life, visible here and now, that is more excellent and perfect than the former ones. And he doesn't have to ask the king if, would you say this sucks? Because he now knows that he's speaking in harmony with the king's mind, and the king is brought into it. The king is transported. The king is in the rapture of his amazing speech. You know? Again, a monk with the subsiding of thinking and pondering by gaining inner tranquility and oneness of mind enters and remains in the second contemplative realm. These are the realms known as the realms of pure matter, you know, still material realm, but in meditative realm, but pure, where gods there are. Each of those realms has three heaven levels in it of pure material realm deities, not normal pleasure-seeking deities, but material realm deities. Millions of them, actually, according to the Buddhist cosmology, which is without thinking and pondering, so there's no need anymore to think, his concentration is so strong. Filled with delight and joy. And with this delight and joy born of concentration, he so suffuses his body that no spot remains untouched. And here he starts this particularly beautiful simile. Just as a lake fed by a spring with no inflow from the east, west, north, or south, where the rain god sends moderate showers from time to time, the water welling up from below, like the kind of bliss you have when it comes from within you, not from gaining and grabbing something and from owning this or from this and that thing, but just comes up from within. The pond is, you know, the spring pond, you know, the water welling up from below, mingling with cool water, would suffuse, fill, and irradiate that cool water so that no part of the pool was untouched by it. I guess the idea is mingling with cool, that means that the inflow is that comes up from below is warm, actually, and it mingles with the cool. And so with this delight and joy born of concentration, he so suffuses his body that no spot remains untouched. This, sire, is a fruit more excellent and perfect than the former ones. Again, a monk with the fading away of delight remains imperturbable, mindful, and clearly aware, and experiences in himself the joy of which the noble, here he says noble. Why didn't he say noble before that? In which the noble ones say, happy is he who dwells with equanimity and mindfulness. And he enters and remains in the third contemplative realm, another three layers of divine planes, of the heavenly pure matter realm planes, or people say form realm, but they really mean matter realm plane. And with this joy devoid of delight, so he's no longer like excited or that little tremble of excitement about having such a joy. It's so gone now. He's like so realistically confident in it. He doesn't sort of need like to, oh great, I've got it. No, it just fills him, you know. So this joy devoid of delight, he so suffuses his body that no spot remains untouched. Just as if in a pond of blue, red, or white lotuses in which the flowers born in the water, grown in the water, not growing out of the water, are fed from the water's depths, those blue, red, or white lotuses would be suffused with the cool water, So with this joy, devoted delight, the monk so suffuses his body that no spot remains untouched. This is the fruit of the homeless life, more excellent and perfect than the former ones. What I think is very important here is in this sort of simile of the pond being connection with deeper reality of the true reality of the world, which is nirvana. There are flowers in this reality. There are differentiated objects in this reality. It's not like just some vast space thing, just bloop off into space, although there is, we'll see where that comes in. But there's actually, it allows for differentiation of beauty. You know? That's very important. It's planting a seed there that's very important against a kind of negative transcendentalist, addicted to transcendence, escapist kind of dualism. Not that people don't ignore that, but he's planting that seed. Again, a monk having given up pleasure and pain, and with the disappearance of former gladness and sadness, you know, his gladness is not the kind that would have an opposite, enters and remains in the fourth dhyana, which is beyond pleasure and pain and purified by equanimity and mindfulness. And he sits suffusing his body with that mental purity and clarification so that no part of his body is untouched by it. Just as if a man were to sit wrapped from head to foot in a white garment so that no part of him was untouched by that garment, so his body is suffused. This is a fruit of the homeless life, more excellent and perfect than the former ones. And so with mind concentrated, purified, and cleansed, so this is the fourth one, which in which there are seven heavenly planes of the gods of the realm of pure form or pure matter. And the topmost of those is one called Akanishta, not lesser than anything, literally means. And that's where Brahma, the sort of highest of the gods, who ordinary people, not Buddha, but ordinary people think created the world, sort of the highest of the gods, Brahma, dwells there in that Akanishta. And later in Mahayana, that's where all the Buddha lands are. But never mind, we'll talk about that later. Though this is the fruit of the homeless life, more excellent and perfect than the former ones. And now he goes through this deeper concentration, and so into what are called the four formless realms, or really the four immaterial realms he's going to enter into, the first of which is known as infinite space. So with mind concentrated, purified, and cleansed, unblemished, free from impurities, malleable, workable, established, and having gained imperturbability, he directs and inclines his mind towards knowing and seeing. And he knows, so he still is very conscious. He's not just blah, you know. And he knows this, my body, is material made up from the four great elements, born of mother and father, fed on rice and gruel, impermanent, liable to be injured and abraded, broken and destroyed. And this is my consciousness, which is bound to it and dependent on it. So there's actually a very subtle level of concentrated discrimination, wisdom is at this point, where body and mind are kind of separated, perceived as separate by the yogin at this point. And I will have to come back very strongly to this point. It is just as if there were a gem, a beryl, like a sapphire or a ruby or an emerald, pure, excellent, well cut into eight facets, clear, bright, unflawed, perfect in every respect, strung on a blue, yellow, red, white, or orange cord. A man with good eyesight taking it in his hand and inspecting it would describe it as such. In the same way as a monk with mind concentrated and purified directs his mind toward knowing and seeing, and he knows this is my material, this is my consciousness. This is a fruit of the homeless life, more excellent and perfect than the former ones. But here, that's really awesome. This is incredible. Just look at that. Now, you would think, if you were dualistically inclined, thinking that nirvana is a leaving of the world. And I think the male yogi Brahmins who are scared of life, sensitive, and are seekers, they're actually seeking to separate themselves from it. They are escapists, actually. And we all are, actually, really. Human beings are. Why do they get so addicted to downers like heroin? In all mass human beings, because it's like an escape, you know. And why are materialists so addicted to the theory that when you die you become nothing? Because they want to escape. You know, so normally, if you were doing the eight different meditative states, what are called the eight absorptions or the meditative states, you have those four contemplative realms of pure form, and then you have infinite space, infinite consciousness, absolute nothingness, which is just a subjective experience as if it were absolute, sort of oblivion state, but it's a state, it isn't actually reality, and beyond consciousness and unconsciousness, which Buddha calls, right away in the Theravada, from the very beginning, he calls the four formless realms, as they translate, or the four immaterial realms, as better translated. And then you would think, then if you extinguish even the sense of being beyond constant unconsciousness, then you hit nirvana. So it's like one long launch into getting out of the world, right? But no, at this point, on the event horizon of where body and mind seem separate, what does he do in the primary dualistic Buddhist Theravada? You know, scripture produces a subtle body instead of leaving the body. So it doesn't actually enter infinite space, but it's at that boundary where he has almost like the mind of the highest God. He reaches the space where the highest God dwells and stops short of going into sort of nothingness apparent, almost seemingly nothingness type realms, but which are just mental states, actually. So, and he with mind concentrated, having gained imperturbability, applies and directs his mind to the production of a mind-made body. And this is actually Tantrayana, I'm sorry. That's the Vajrayana. The Vajrayana, all that Tantra is becoming so conscious of the subtle levels of evolutionary causality that you go into a subtle plane, and which is what a mandala is a doorway to. And in that subtle plane, then you can accelerate a process of dying and being reborn and dying and reborn as a bodhisattva, as a being who, which is already also taught here because Buddha teaches his 500 previous lives, how he progressed from this animal form and that one and that one and that one toward human and this kind of human, that kind of human, finally to where he could be a Buddha. So that concept is also there, but although he doesn't say to the arhats, you have to do that too. He leaves them because he knows that those male brahminical types, they don't want to work that hard. They don't want to get in the kitchen. They don't want to be female. They want to get out. But this is what he tells right there. Instead of going out into infinite space, he says you create a mind-made body. And it's just as if a man were to draw out a reed from its sheath. He might think, this is the reed and this is the sheath. Reed and sheath are different. Now the reed has been pulled from the sheath. Or as if a man would draw a sword from the scabbard. He might think this is the sword. This is the scabbard. Sword and the scabbard are different. Now the sword has been drawn from a scabbard. Or if a man were to draw a snake from its old skin, he might think this is the snake. This is the skin. Snake and skin are different. Now the snake has been drawn from its skin. In the same way, a monk with his mind concentrated directs his mind to the production of a mind-made body. And he draws that body out of this body, having form, mind-made, complete with all its limbs and faculties. This is the fruit of the homeless life, more excellent and perfect than the former one. So he is teaching without elaborating, actually, Vajrayana. But he hasn't talked about Bodhisattvahood. He's not talking about, this is not an esoteric text. So he's not hiding a thing, esoterically. But he's not also explicating it. So he knows that people are not going to really pay attention to that. They're just going to take it this way, which he does say. And he with mind concentrated applies and directs his mind to the various supernormal powers. He then enjoys different powers because he knows the king will like this. And you could call these accomplishments, I think, are better, we decided. Different accomplishments. Being one, he becomes many. Being many, he becomes one. He appears and disappears. He passes through fences, walls, and mountains unhindered as if through air. He sinks into the ground and emerges from it as if it were water. He walks on the water without breaking the surface as if on land. He flies. Sounds like Jesus. He flies. I'm just doing a thing on the internet with Andrew Harvey on Buddha and Jesus. So I just thought about it. He walks. He flies cross-legged through the sky like a bird with wings. He even touches and strokes with his hand the sun and moon, mighty and powerful as they are. And he travels in the body as far as the Brahma world. So because this happens on the boundary between form and formlessness, you know. Just as a skilled potter or his assistant can make from well-prepared clay whatever kind of bowl he likes, or skilled ivory carver's assistant can produce. Now this is the fruit of the home life, more perfect and more wonderful than the previous, he says. And then he goes through the different supernormal powers, divine ear, knowledge of others' minds, that's telepathy. I want to finish. He knows the surpassed mind. He knows all about the mind. He knows the concentrated mind to be concentrated. He knows the unconcentrated mind. He knows the liberated mind to be liberated. He knows the unliberated mind to be unliberated. Just as a woman or a man or a young boy, fond of his appearance, a narcissist, might examine his face, means put woman first, men are worse, might examine his face in a brightly polished mirror or in water, and by examination would know whether there was a spot there or not. So the monk with mind concentrated directs his mind to the knowledge of others' minds. This is the fruit of the homeless life. So he can just really sees in tiny detail what others are feeling and thinking. He with mind concentrated applies his mind and directs his mind to the knowledge of previous existences. He remembers many previous existences, one birth, two, three, four, five, 10, 20, and so on and so on. My name was so-and-so, even in different aeons, in different big bangs, different cycles, you know. He remembers them, and he knows which village he was in, and this is the fruit of the homeless life, more perfect and wonderful. And then again, this is divine eye, where you see things all over the universe. You can see the hells, you can see the preta realms, you see the animal realms, and you just like you can see from a high mountain in a far distance, so this is a fruit. And now this is the most important. And here we're coming to the end, almost the end. So here's the Four Noble Truths. He takes the king into the Four Noble Truths. He knows as it really is, this is suffering, this is the origin of suffering, this is the cessation of suffering, freedom from suffering, you can translate that. This is the path leading to the cessation from suffering. And he knows it as it really is, these are the corruptions, the origin of the corruptions, the cessation of corrupt path leading to the cessation of, I don't like corruptions, I call them addictions, actually. And through his knowing and seeing like anger, hatred, delusion, pride, envy, these are what they are. So corruption is not as good. It's addiction. Defilement would be an old word, a Christian word that wouldn't be bad, but addiction is the best. And this is deliverance, and he knows birth is finished, the holy life has been led, done is what had to be done, there is nothing further here. And this is nirvana now. This is a simile for nirvana. And he says, sire, in the midst of the mountains there were a pond, clear as a polished mirror, where a man with good eyesight standing on the bank could see oyster shells, gravel banks, and shoals of fish on the move or stationary. And he might think, this pond is clear, there are oyster shells. So with mind concentrated, he knows birth is finished, the holy life has been led, done is what had to be done, there is nothing further here. This is the fruit of the homeless life. Visible and more perfect than the previous, which is visible here and now, which is more excellent and perfect than the previous fruits. And sire, there is no fruit of the homeless life visible here and now that is more excellent and perfect than this. And what I want to say is this simile for nirvana undercuts the escapist idea that nirvana is outside the world, right in the midst of so-called dualistic Buddhism. Because the simile is you're seeing clearly all kinds of things, but now you see the relative things totally clearly because you are one with them all, actually, because you have expanded to identify with all of them. And these supernormal things are all about all expanding, and the last one of remembering the full lives is expanding in time, and the other is expanding in space with other beings, you know. So then the king is really happy. He says, excellent, Lord, excellent. It is as if someone were to set up what had been knocked down or point out the way to one who had got lost or to bring an oil lamp into a dark place, so that those with eyes could see what was there. Just so Bhagavan, blessed Lord, has expounded the Dhamma, the teaching in various ways. And I, Lord, go for refuge to the Bhagavan, to the blessed Buddha, to the Dhamma, to the Sangha. May the blessed Lord accept me from this day forth as a lay follower, as long as life shall last. But now he makes a confession. Transgression overcame me, Lord, foolish, erring, and wicked as I was, in that I, for the sake of the throne divine, deprived my father, that good man and just king, of his life. May the blessed Lord accept my confession of my evil deed, that I may restrain myself in future. But notice he doesn't mention his mother. He can't go that deep in himself, even though he's been taken on this, hinted, he's been given this taste of nirvana. It's not enough. All he mentions is that. Then the Buddha accepts wherever he could make it. He says, indeed, sire, transgression overcame you when you deprived your father, that good man and just king, of his life. And Buddha also doesn't mention, and by the way, your mom. Maybe he thinks it's too much for him, or for whatever reason, he feels he can't get there. But since you have acknowledged the transgression and confessed as is right, we will accept it. For meaning the monk, the mendicant order, because the mendicants are always doing that. They're constantly confessing to each other, like, they confess, like, I slurped my soup at supper and disturbed your mind by slurping. I sneezed in my lecture and you were so upset when I made a loud sneezing noise. They little tiny little things, because they're so sensitive the way they live with each other. And also big things. I lied, or I did this, I did that. But the biggest thing is, you know, I had sex, I killed someone, I stole something, and I pretended to a spiritual attainment that I had not attained. That kind of lie. Those four things. Then they're out as monk when they do that. They're out of the community when they do that. Anyway, he says, we'll accept it. So, but otherwise, they accept each other's confessions. For he who acknowledges his transgressions as such and confesses it for betterment in the future will grow in the noble discipline. At this, the king said, Lord, permit me to depart now. I am busy and have much to do. Do now, your majesty, as you think fit. And this is the sad part of this sutra. You know, the king can't get further, you know, because he can't remember the mother. That's the key. And so then the king left, and he was very happy with as far as he got. He has a certain level of his anxiety. But then, as soon as the king was going, the Lord said, the king is done for. His fate is sealed, monks. But if the king had not deprived his father that good man and just king of his life, but he also doesn't mention the mother. Then father and mother, that good man and just king and good woman and just queen, he showed that really. Then as he sat here, the pure and spotless Dharma eye would have arisen in him. Thus the Lord spoke, and the monks delighted and rejoiced at his words. That's a non-dual teaching of the dualistic Buddhist, one of their most basic sutras. And yet, they persist later on in the commentaries in Sri Lanka. They talk about you go beyond the plane of beyond consciousness, unconscious, and you hit nirvana. But even in the parinirvana sutta of the Buddha, which describes his own attaining Buddhahood, when he passes from his coarse body, he goes up to these four jhanas himself. It said, you know, the sutta says, describes his mental process. Then he goes up through those four formless realms or immaterial realms to the highest one, the most subtle one, which is the, not really highest, but most subtle one, beyond consciousness. Then he comes back down to the base of the form realm of pure form, the boundary between that and the desire realm. And then he goes up to this same boundary where he leaves you here, right on the boundary of the Brahma world, you know. And that's where he then leaves the body and becomes nirvana. So the idea, if they connected that to this sutta, they would say that instead of leaving the world, which is where, you know, later on they object to the universal vehicle, the Mahayana, by saying that Buddha didn't leave any body. Buddha left his body and left forever. And he's not here. He said, like, rely on the teaching, but he's not. You can't have Buddha showing up. You can't have Buddha still present, non-dually enveloping the whole world. You cannot. And they complain about that. But that hint, I just connected these. It's the first time. Thank you. That's the hint. If that hint, where he doesn't go into the formless realms there with the king, only at that plane he stays. And then when he dies, he also dies from that plane. The hint is that he separates mind and body, but creates a subtle body for the mind. Because mind is always what has a body. That's later in tantric science. Mind is never without a body. And body is never without a mind. That sort of thing. It's really interesting. Thank you very much. That's all. Please don't approach me to ask questions after, because I'm sick. Actually, normally, I didn't realize it would take so long. I would stop a few minutes ahead and give you a chance to ask some questions. You can find this text, hopefully, read it. And I think they may be online somewhere, maybe not. But it's something really great. And I'm sorry for my sneezing and my cold and everything. I hope I will not be having it next week.
Thank you.
Okay. Thank you very much. Good night. Thank you. Okay.